to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Madam Clerk, if I could have a roll call, please.
Alderman Bowman. Alderman Dahlman.
Present.
Alderman Milner. Absent. Alderman Coburn.
Here.
Alderman Dickerson.
Here.
Alderman Long.
Here.
Alderman Stahl.
Here.
Alderman Stafford.
Here.
Mayor Hassey.
Present, and we do have a quorum. We do have some ceremonial matters tonight. John, if you'd join me up here. John Tholen, how are you, sir?
I'm very well, thank you.
John has been with us for 10 years now. Does it seem like 10 years? Or does it feel like a blur?
Well, not so long, just for me, though. I've never been 10 years with anyone or any place.
It is definitely a big accomplishment, and we want to congratulate you on that and present you with this award for your 10 years.
Y'all step together a little bit more. There you go. Nice smile. And one more, please. Keep smiling. Thank you.
All right. Well, we hope to see you another 10 years.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you. At this time, I'll open public participation. Anybody who has anything to bring before the board that is not on our regularly scheduled agenda, please feel free to approach the microphone. Be sure to let Kim know your name and address for the record.
Can we have your name?
Doug Walton.
And your address?
2800 South Burkhart.
2800? Okay.
Good evening.
How you people doing today?
Pretty good.
Listen, we're going to have some problems on Burkhart with this new truck stop coming in, Loves. Of course, you know, it's a done deal now. We can't do anything about the truck stop, okay? But the issue now is the truckers coming up there with the barricades on both ends of the road. They're knocking down the barricades. They're destroying people's property up on that part of the road, my neighbors. And then plus on top of that, once they get the barricades down, they get the road opened up on the north end where Loves is going in. What are we going to do about the trucks running up and down this road from point A to point B, back and forth, from both these truck stops? This is going to turn another Front Street South, like in Kansas City, if you know what I'm talking about. That's going to be a major problem. What we want to know is what we can do about getting some barricades up permanent to keep these 18-wheelers off Burkhart Drive. I've talked to Clint several times on the phone in person, and Clint's helped me out a bunch. And I want y'all to know that. You know, he says that we need to come up here and talk to you people. That's why we're here tonight. But this is going to be a major problem. It's a residential street. They say, we'll call the law. We're about to wear the law out. They can be there when they can get there. If they can't be there, they're not in time to get these guys. Just last week, there was one stuck right across from my house. He was buried deep in the mud. Tow truck had to come out, blah, blah, blah. And that's just one example. So, you know, I got heavy fines, property damage, and this and that and whatever. But something is going to have to be done. Burkhart Drive is not wide enough. It's not a heavy enough street. It's a safety issue on top of that. I see these truck drivers going all the way down to the north end. They see the barricades. They ignore the signs on the south end. They do it anyway. They back all the way up. I've seen it more than once. And I'm thinking, you back up that hill, and somebody's coming up from the south, they're going to hit that truck right in the rear end. And something bad's going to happen. So I want you people to realize what we're going through up there on Burkhart Drive. You know, you're going to have two truck stops a mile and a quarter apart from each other. And they're going to try to use that for beeline back and forth. There's no stopping it unless something's done. So what I want to know is what the game plan is with the city and the county and maybe the state to get some resolve with it. I talked to you once, Brian.
Yes, we did.
You remember the conversation? Mm-hmm. And the next day you did good because they had barricades up and these dump trucks won't run back and forth from one job to the other job. Mm-hmm. But they still come up. Mm-hmm. Two neighbors here that live right next door to me are going to show you pictures and blah, 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 and whatever about what's going on up there. But something has to get done with this. It's going to get out of control.
Well, the road now, you have the one entrance. So, I mean, the barricade that we could add, see about getting barricades added to make a zigzag. The issue you raise is what to do after the fact.
Right.
That's something I don't know if we've thought that through on you know, how you could, I mean, you can't have barricades up 24/7 on that road, so.
Well, that's the problem right there. I mean, the city and the county will be collecting taxes off these two truck stops. And I'm thinking, hey, take that tax money, you get, you know, guards on each end of the road, whatever it takes, because that's a residential road. And I'm thinking, actually myself, these guys that own these truck stops, big money people, is going to try to eventually buy this somehow and get access to this road. When that's the residential road, they're going to have their way. You know, my folks bought that property up there in 1971, and now that's what's come to. We've been there for a long time, and all of a sudden these guys come in and say, hey, we're going to do what we want to do. I'm thinking, this isn't right. Nothing about this is right. We weren't informed about truck stops coming in. I wasn't anyway, personally, or we'd been up here talking about it before the boat even came up. It never did happen. We had no idea this was going to happen. And all of a sudden, bam, there it is. They're building these truck stops. I'm thinking, you know what? I'm not against development, progress, anything like that. I'm thinking that the last thing the world needs is another truck stop. Anything but a truck stop. You're going to have congestion, trash, pollution, and noise for what? A trade-off on a handful of nickel-dime jobs, dishwashing, clean up the lot, whatever they do, their truck stop for what? For what reason? Love's going to be the one to come out on top, just like the Shaft Brothers says. I mean, that's the whole point right there. It's all the money. And we're the ones suffering for it. We're going to suffer for it. Unless something's done.
Well, we can definitely do some checking on the road and what could be done. I mean, like I said, for now, I think if we can see about getting the barricade, maybe that the cars can make it through, but
yeah.
A large truck. But the other issue, we'll have to do a little more research on what could be done to help prevent or deter that. I mean, the weigh station doesn't help either with it being right there. I'm surprised they haven't utilized that road more in the past to be the weigh station.
They've been doing that for 50 years. When my folks bought that place, that was a gravel road up there, okay? And they were avoiding the waste station at that time, and they'd take that gravel road. And now they're doing it even more. And now they're doing it with barricades up. They just knocked barricades down. Doesn't matter. You know, I've run more than one of them off my property trying to turn around, and so have my neighbors, and I asked every one of these guys, say, what do you got? You can't see the sign down at the end of the road? They said, yeah. But my GPS says to go this way. I'm thinking, oh, wait a minute. You gonna let your GPS tell you what to do, or you gonna watch these signs the state put up on this road? I mean, which one is it? But that's always their excuse. That's if you can understand their English. You know, Spanish, Jamaican, whatever it is. I'm not trying to make a joke out of it, but that's what we've been going through for the last several months. You know, we're the ones getting put out, because now we go at least twice as far to get into town.
Right.
Okay. Well, who's going to compensate us for that? Nobody. That's on us. And Brick Plant Road is the same way. They're supposed to be illegal out there too, but they take it just like it's, you know, 49 Highway out here. It makes no difference to them. So, I'm looking at the future when these things get opened up. What's going to happen to this road? Brian, like I said, I talked to you once on the phone, you got that one issue resolved, and I appreciate it, but these barricades are gonna be coming down, and that's when things are gonna start happening.
Well, you definitely raised some concerns that we need to look at. I won't argue with that.
You know, everybody's voted for this thing, I'm thinking, you know what? Why aren't they both the same, that's been a quarter of a mile from their backyard like it is mine? I mean, seriously. People on the side of town, they're gonna say, well, yeah, that's cool, you know, we got a new truck stop, McDonald's going in there. I'm thinking, yeah, if that'd been in your backyard, would you vote for it that way? I'm thinking also, same time, for all of our troubles, we've been through on that road up there since they shut it down. They're gonna give us a free happy meal for it. What are we gonna get in return for this? I mean, seriously, we're the ones getting put out at their convenience. They're talking about getting this road connected back together anytime soon. To me, that should have been priority to start with, to get that road tied back in. So they're out there dragging their feet, doing whatever they do, blah, 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 you know. Plus the convenience, listening to all the construction noise, 6, 7 days a week, 10 hours a day, you know. It's not nice, it's really nice, living a quarter of a mile or something like that. Anyway, I said my piece, and that's what I stand on, so.
Well, we appreciate you coming.
Well, I appreciate you listening to me.
You bet.
Not many people will.
Well, we'll see what we can come up with on the road for a deterrent. That's a good point.
Yeah, especially
that. We'll see if we can't do something about the other end, if we can't get something set up to create a zigzag.
Anything, yeah.
I don't think the county would be opposed to that. I think that's their end. Did the county put something up?
They just knocked it right down.
Same time, though, like I'm saying, Brian, once they take these barricades down, it's just going to be wide open back and forth truck drivers. And, well, they can't be out there all the time.
Yeah.
You know, it's just impossible. Unless they hire full-time somebody on each end watching this thing. That's something I can come up with. I guess the next step may be what? Landmines? I don't know. I hope not too. You got to get realistic about this, right? Because, like I said, we're the ones up there going through this stuff.
Right.
You know, so.
Okay.
Okay. Sounds, I appreciate it.
All right. We appreciate it.
Okay.
All right. Thank you.
Thanks.
My name's Ken Brown. I live at 2811 South Burkhardt Drive.
2811?
Yes.
Good evening.
Evening, gentlemen, ladies. Basically, we know what's going on here. I just want to add to it that I've got, it's an ongoing problem since it's been closed. I actually have damage to my property. I may be the only one on Brookhart with a concrete driveway. It's severely damaged. And ruts in the yard. I think my neighbor Randy actually has some video or pictures. Some of the vehicles turned around. I know even the trash truck was doing a turnaround in my drive. I've got an estimate for $5,900. It's cracked all the way in the ruts. And I'm just the same thing. Even when it was opened up, I don't know if any of you folks know what it's like to have an 80,000-pound semi going down your street. My house is about 60 feet from there. My window's shaved. And, you know, as long as there's a scale house there and there's a road behind it, and it's closed to commercial vehicles and through traffic, it's a problem. It's only going to get worse.
Are they slipping through there at night as well, middle of the night? I would assume so. They drive all the time. Have you been woke up at night with these passing through there? Or?
More so since they've closed it, because you're seeing the lights and you're hearing the air brakes. And they're backing up. And, they basically use whatever. They've actually done a U-turn in my yard. They've used driveways and whatnot. But I'm not really opposed to the truck stop. I'm a truck driver myself. I understand that drivers need a place too. if you go to Peculiar, that place is always full. They're on exit ramps everywhere. But it's gonna get worse. I don't have the answer to it, but it's a problem that, you know, we know it's gonna get worse. Appreciate your time.
Well, we appreciate you coming up and voicing your concern and letting us know. I'd say we something we definitely need to take a look at for when that opens up.
And hopefully you'll keep us abreast of what solutions we might be able to come up with.
You bet.
Thank you.
Hey, sir, one question. On the damages, have you seen if they're going to take care of?
Yeah, I didn't explain that now. Randy actually videotaped the guy that did the U-turn.
Right, I talked to Randy about it, but he didn't. I mean, at that time, he didn't know.
There's no company name or any license plate. Basically, I'm just doing this for my insurance. I have a $1,000 deductible on my house. So to get it fixed, it comes out of my pocket. And they're tired of me calling. They're actually like, well, you know, we got your claim and everything, but is it going to stop if we fix it now? I'm like, well, we probably shouldn't do it just yet. They're going to keep turning around. So, you know, I haven't caught anybody, you know, backing in my driveway, but that's away from his camp.
I didn't know how that would work, if who would be liable for that.
Since I have no evidence of which truck did it or whatever, I haven't settled with my insurance company either. It's just it's pending. But I'm upset over it, you know, stand to lose some money and or just live with damage to my property.
I don't know anybody would be happy with that. Yeah.
All right, well, thanks for your time. Oh, sure.
I guess I'm a little confused. If it's a brook part is, you know, all the way through, so why are they zigzagging through and then why don't they just go on through to the other side? Why are they turning around?
It's closed because of a lot of truck stop.
That's a problem.
That's the road
they're
moving.
South Commercial
isn't
Brook.
Isn't there barriers at both sides, at both ends?
They can only get through the one end. They end down at 7 Highway.
It's completely closed.
That's the barrier. At Commercial Street, that's where they're redoing the intersection. You cannot get through Brookhart there. So they're thinking it's a through road because their GPS shows this road cuts through. And when they get to the end, they see the construction. They have no choice. They can't go through a barrier. They're going to have to drive through the construction site. They
once
can't they do
pop
that.
Over the hill. Mm-hmm. Just think like if you go to 7 Highway, so like you go to Clinton, you turn right, and then turn right on Brookhart, there's a sign there that says
don't, and that's where they're going.
That's where they're going through. We haven't put up another one.
There's two barricades.
Two barricades, like one like this and one like this, so that a car could zigzag through it, but a truck couldn't. But it got knocked over and it was in the ditch.
Well, and
it was about a couple days later.
Also, it says no commercial vehicles, no three trucks.
Right.
Yeah.
And they get to the top of the hill.
And then they see the construction.
There's no turnaround. Other than our driveways or the water department that just got put in.
Yeah. It's hard for me to turn my truck around.
Yeah. So that's.
It's not very wide.
Can't read the signs. I don't know what goes through a truck driver's mind. He just thinks one last thing I'll say is, living on that street, I think 90-some% of the truck drivers that come down, they're either overweight, they're over 80,000 pounds, they're illegal, over on hours, license, whatever. 90-some% of them are illegal. If I got pulled over on there, that's what I would say. My GPS told me to go down here.
Blame it on the GPS.
Yeah.
That would be the perfect answer because I don't know any, there's no other reason for a truck to go down
here. I guess that excuses not being able to read the sign, so.
Exactly. Short of a flashing neon sign, I don't know what else we can do right now. You got barricades, you got signs, it's illegal, everybody knows it. And, it's going through, but it's just going to get worse. That's my main concern, is what we're going to do.
All right, well, thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
Yeah, for her.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening. Good evening to you all. I have some pictures that I've taken, and pardon me for the quality of some of them. Best I could do, taken from camera phone to computer. Okay, these first two pictures, they're the pictures of the signs at 275th Street. Now, there is a double barricade backup.
That's good.
And my only objection to where it's at, it's really called Marley's, which is probably 1/8 mile from 275th Street to their place. When the semi comes off the highway and turns, they can't, and I've turned there before, you can't really read the whole barricade. Because in that truck, you're trying to make the turn. If the barricades were up, just on the north side of Marley's Drive, that way semis could get into Marley's, because they do go in and out there. That way they could, you know, do their thing, and the rest of the road would be quiet. These next two are just a couple of the trucks that I caught going down a road. You can tell that red truck was trying to back up in my drive. Now, I'm not so much worried about the straight trucks, because they can maneuver a whole lot better than a semi. Semis, that's a whole other deal. This picture was from a semi that turned around in my yard November 8th. And the cops were called out at that time, both city and county. And these last two pictures are of Mr. Brown's yard, where semi, and I've got it on VCR taped, because I've got a camera that points towards the road. And after this all first started, when they were starting to back up in our roads and in our drives in our yards, I tried to monitor it. And the semi goes past my drive, realizes he can't go any farther, backs up, and he makes a big swing right through his yard. Unfortunately, the cab was all yellow, no name on the trailer. And there's a picture of the semi that got stuck a week ago today in the neighbor's yard, which I think is 2801 Brickhart Drive. And they got stopped by the city and county. Plus, and these are the damage. The first picture is where my mailbox is on the opposite side of the road in Mr. Brown's yard. And the second one is where they tried to back up into my yard and left the nice ruts. And they managed to push the mailbox over about a 45-degree angle. Now, that's the only property damage they could get him on. Because if I understand right, there's a 35-foot easement from the center of the road to your yard, or the neighbor's yard, that if it's damaged, you can't file a claim on that. Is that correct? You know?
I don't know the answer.
I don't believe that's correct.
Okay. Do you know what it is?
Well, it depends upon the right-of-way, but typically if the right-of-way is then to the shoulder, if there's damage beyond that, it would depend upon the right-of-way, but I don't think there's any magic to 35 feet.
Okay. Well, I know the power lines are 35 foot off the center, so that's one of those moments.
They probably have a separate easement for that.
That's true. They could have been. I also want to address a couple of things that the previous two neighbors talked about. Should we have gotten any type of notice that this was coming in, and all of a sudden, boom, the road was going to be closed?
Rick, do you know, were there notices sent of any kind?
Well, notices were sent for the rezoning and the things that are required for that.
Mm-hmm.
But those are a couple hundred feet out. The adjacent property owners for the vacation of the right-of-ways, but that wasn't going to talk about, you know, what's happening here anyway.
Okay, so they wouldn't have been up on Brickhart Drive, where everybody lives, that they wouldn't have gotten
notice? No, they wouldn't have gone that far.
Okay, all right, that's what I wanted
to know. Now, for the road closures or anything that's required to, just the signs? Okay.
All right. Yeah, because I know one morning I get up to go to town, you go over the hill, and boom, I can't go any further.
Mm-hmm.
When did that?
Okay.
And also, it's like they were asking, who's going to patrol this? Is it going to be city, county, combination, you know, highway patrol? You know, because that's one concern that I really have. When those two semis were doing their little thing, you know, the city was first out there. You know, they were right on the ball pretty quick. I know county response time can be anywhere from 10 to 30 minutes, you know, depending on where they are in the county.
Correct.
And the sheriff's guys all the time tell me, if you see one, call us. Well, why? You know, because you're never going to get there unless you happen to be down the road. And, you know, they do the damage, and if I'm not right there and get the name of the truck or license plate number, it's a waste of my time, you know. So that was another concern. And I know I stopped one semi driver here, it's been probably 2 months ago, that was turning around in public water district number 4. They built a big place right next to mine. And I asked the guy, I said, what are you doing up here? The road's closed. He's yelling. I thought we'd get through. You can't get through, the road's closed. It says road's closed. Anyway, a third of them are nice, a third of them are just lost, and a third of them are just jerks. And this guy was a jerk. He told me that if I didn't move my truck, he was going to run over. And he was a driver from the night transportation. I called the company. I don't know what they did. I had never heard back. I never followed up. So they probably just hung the phone up and that was it. But anyway, that's the type of people that we deal with. And head sheriff's department deputy also make the comment that when they get both these truck stops open, that they're more than likely going to make Brookhart a truck route, which means they're going to have to move the pole in the back, you know, power poles back. And I don't know what they're going to do with the road. The road is not in good shape now as it is. And it's not thick enough to handle those big trucks.
Now, I know Brick Plant at one time was a truck route, but the county took it off the truck route. So
right.
I had not heard anything about Brookhart and the truck route. I'm not saying they hadn't talked about it. I just hadn't heard anything. So.
Yeah, and it's like Mr. Walton said, when the semis come down the road, they're doing it for a reason. You know, it's not just, oh, we got lost. You know, the scale is just right over the hill. You know, they know where they're at. And then once they, and like you said too, once they get both these open, it's just a freeway. You know, and who's going to pay for that? I mean, obviously it's going to be the county because it's mostly a county road. You know, there are just three houses in the city and the rest of our county. And this only really affects, I'd say 5 or 6 homeowners at the very end of the road. You know, the rest of them, you know, they don't have yards big enough to turn around in. Mm-hmm. It's just our lucky ones. And they said they were going to have that open by the 22nd. That's 15 days. And I've talked to different concrete guys, and they said, well, it's got to take at least 2 weeks to cure. Mm-hmm. So what's the status on that? Have you heard it?
Rick, do we have any status update on where they are with getting that opened up?
The developer's here, so he's probably
he can address that
better about that.
Okay. Yeah, because I know it. A couple times I rode down on my four-wheel to just see what they were doing. Mm-hmm. And I got a chance to talk to a couple of guys. They said, yeah, we got to have it done by the 22nd. Mm-hmm. We're not going to get it done.
I'll guarantee. Say that's a lot of concrete.
A lot of concrete, a lot of area, you know, plus the sides, or whatever they call it. Plus, that's a good 2 foot, 2.5 foot hall that they got to build up. Mm-hmm. So that's going to be pushing it. And I guess the last thing is, what's it going to do to our property values with all this stuff coming in? You know, I mean, I've heard a lot of bad stuff about trucks, truck stops with all the people that, you know, that are around them, you know, the bums, the women. And Doug's just over the hill. You know, they can just, you know, cross the road, walk up over the hill, and they're in his backyard. And I'm right next to him. You know?
That I don't have the answer for.
Okay. But I just like to know, you know. I've been trying to go through all the other venues, you know, talk to several people. Anywhere from city, county, state, MoDOT, even called Donna Fouch. Mm-hmm. And I don't know whether she's the one that actually got that double barricade put back up or not. But and one of the main reasons why they couldn't put a permanent offset barricade was for the, like, fire trucks, mm-hmm. you know, if they had an emergency down there, you know, that was their reason for not having put it up.
Right.
But, yeah, we sure need to, you know, look into doing something. So, anyway.
I would agree with that.
Council, I thank you.
Thank you.
You know, I look forward to, you know, finding out, what you have to do.
We'll see what we can do.
All right, thank you.
All righty, thank you, sir.
Randy.
Anyone else for public participation tonight?
I haven't been here for long, so I've got a lot to talk about. No. Jack Cotton. I'm kind of on the same line of what they're talking about. Out there where I live, out there on Locust, which is out there at the Harrisonville Properties 2 and Hamilton Court, there have been several of us talked to the trash company. There's no turnaround up in there that they've ever put in that place for people to get up there and turn around. Those trash trucks, they turn around down there on the main Locust, and they back up through there. And they come up through there just to help for election. And I know I talked to dispatch one time, and they said, you know, if something like that, call 911, and they would, well, we don't always know when they're going to be there. Well, they've knocked over several of the barricades where they got for the trash containers to sit. And they do. They just back up that street like nobody's been there. There's also people come up through there thinking that they can get to the park, so they park in our parking spots, get out and go play soccer and stuff like that. So I would like to see, and I'd like to talk to Chief Halter if there's a possibility that we could get a little bit more patrolling out in that area. Anyway, just to see if we can stop some of that. Because like I say, somebody's going to get hit with all them trash trucks coming up there. Because like I say, they just, and they've been in trouble all over the city, in Kansas City, for doing the same darn thing. So anyway, I thank you.
All right, thank you.
Well, I, wait a minute. No, I get better talking. Give up.
Doug Miller, 403 Locust. Just an alternative suggestion on barricades out there on Brookhart. The old concrete plant of Locust, amongst the whistle, they have some concrete blocks that are hand poured. They're about 4 feet long, 2 feet wide, about 3 foot tall. You might put some of them out there to make, and those trucks aren't going to shut them around like they did barricades. He's got quite a few of them up there, so you might talk to us about those.
The only thing I was told on that is because of fire truck again.
Well, you can still stagger them up, but an 18-wheeler ain't going
to. Right, that's what me and David originally talked about.
One concrete barrier.
They've got some big ones
that
are hand poured, and they're not going to push them around.
Right.
Yeah, we wanted to stop by where the gas plant is up above that, so their truck could get in there.
Right.
The county had already set that one down there, so then, well, you talked to Luke and I talked to Luke, so then they put another one. Decided to zigzag, but then they knocked it down the day we went out there.
These blocks are big enough, they're not going to push them around.
Yeah, I know, that's what I wanted.
So you might, just an alternative idea.
But it didn't, so.
Thanks, Clint.
Yep.
Would make good vote numbers.
Yes, they would.
I just wanted to let you know that the individuals that did speak in regards to Burkhart are actually, they're in the back talking with the less representative.
Okay, very good.
We may need to adjust things around, sir.
Okay, no, we can do that, you know, not a problem. Anyone else tonight? Seeing no one, I will close public participation and we'll move on to the approval of the minutes. We first have minutes from the special meeting from September 16th, 2015.
Second.
I have a motion from Alderman Dickerson and a second from Alderman Nolan. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Minutes are approved. And next we have the meeting minutes from the special meeting from October 26th.
Move to approve.
Second.
I have a motion from Alderman Dickerson, a second from Alderman Nolan. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Minutes are approved. And we have the minutes of the regular meeting from November 16th.
Move to approve.
Second.
And again, I have a motion from Alderman Dickerson and then a second from Alderman Dahlman. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Amendments are approved. Moving on. At this time, I will open the public hearing to for the vacation of a portion of Brookhart Drive adjacent to Love's Development. Is there anyone here tonight that would like to speak at this public hearing? Seeing no one, I will close the public hearing.
Do we need to wait for the gentleman from Love's who's visiting with the people here concerned?
The vacation piece, was he needing?
He doesn't necessarily have to speak in public hearing. He can do it if you have questions during the staff report and things like that.
Okay. So. Sounds good. Do we need to wait for him for the ordinance then?
I'd say probably yes.
Okay. All right, well, we will skip ahead to Council Bill 094 at this time.
Council Bill 094 is a resolution of the Harrisonville Board of Aldermen authorizing the city administrator to execute a preliminary design-build agreement with Burns McDonald for emergency repairs of the wastewater treatment plant amount not to exceed $15,000.
Good evening, Mayor and Board members. Again, this falls right back into our work session. We had an issue with the floor. It's heaved up, and we've had Burns McDonald come out and preliminary look at it, and this would just be finalizing that contract with them so that we can actually pay them. If there's any other questions from the work session, I'd be more than happy to answer them.
Anyone have any further questions?
If this is a resolution, we don't need two votes?
We don't need two votes on a resolution. We just need a majority of the members present.
Recommend we approve.
Second.
I have a motion from Alderman Coburn, a second from Alderman Dickerson. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? And Council Bill 094 becomes Resolution R047.
Thank you.
Council Bill 095.
Council 059 is a resolution authorizing the city administrator to restore the fundraising for an IT specialist position in the 2016 budget and to accept amendments to the pay compensation structure.
Mayor and members of the board, we had in the budget for 2016, we had proposed a position for an IT specialist, and the board heard that at their preliminary budget workshop, and everybody approved that. When the budget was actually approved, the funding level had been changed, had been reduced on that. There wasn't any change or notice that was given to the board or to the rest of the staff on that either. But what we're proposing in tonight's action is to put it to the level that the board talked about and approved in your preliminary budget workshops when we went over all those different items. There's no impact on the dollar amount of the budget because there's enough money in the budget to do that. It's just a matter of changing the personnel classification that's in there and just making you aware of it. That's what we're doing is it's restoring it to what it is that we talked about in the board and giving us preliminary approval of when we had those meetings back in July or August or whatever it was. If you have any questions about it, I can answer. Marcel is here, Jeremy Smith is here, our network administrator, systems administrator, whatever his title is.
Well,
I can
break this down for the simple guy on the end, Mike, but it sounds like what you're selling me in the easiest words is you're not asking for more money, you're just asking for a change of format?
Right, and that change of format is to make it to what it was that we first talked about. Okay. So we're not trying to change anything. We're trying to restore it back to the way it was we all talked about it and the board approved so that we can, when we proceed with hiring that position, we can hire it at the level that we talked about and try to get somebody with the qualifications.
This was discovered when they went to start to list for the job, they realized it wasn't at the level needed, and so they can't post for the job without having that approved. So we need to get this back to where it was so they can proceed with getting him some help.
It's a 2016 budget position, but that's only a few weeks away, and when we were starting to get things ramped up and ready for that, we discovered that that had been some error had been made somewhere in that, so we need to get that corrected. Again, no impact on the dollar amounts or anything.
Thank you.
Any further questions? Seeing none, I entertain a motion to approve.
So moved.
Motion from Alderman Stoll.
I'll second that.
And a second from Alderman Bowman. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? And Council Bill 095 becomes Resolution R-048. Council Bill 096.
Council Bill 096 is a resolution of the Board of Aldermen to approve the change order number 8 to the Lehman Construction Contract for the Highway 71-291 Partners in Progress Transportation Development District in an amount of $24,609.06.
Good evening, Dave Gibbs.
Mayor, members of the board. It's just one of the standard change orders. This was necessary for Class A excavation, which is was that actually occurred at the intersection of the Walmart entrance. The soil was not sufficient that they had to over excavate, put in gravel, so that you'd have a stable subgrade to put the road on. What we have found, and this is true on, we're going to find on Mechanic Street, is that when the road was initially built, what they did is just put in base over the existing ditches, and they didn't dig down and remove any of the old ditch material, and that's why our Highway 7's failing, and that was what they ran into at Walmart. So this is just work that needed to be done. It's $24,609.60. We have an opportunity to review it as part of our Phase 2 agreement so that we can tell when we're approaching the $1.5 million, which was the maximum we were going to allow on Phase 2. And it puts us at this point in time at $1,176,695, shows that we're still a long ways from doing it. I don't anticipate any major change orders from this point on. Everything's pretty well known. The only unknown is temporary markings. They're in the process of starting to change lanes so they can do other concrete work. And with cold weather, the temporary markings have a tendency to come up. And when they have, because of safety, they have to put them back down. That is an additional cost. So it's going to be minor, but those types of cost is probably going to occur here in the future.
So this change order, is this applied, if I heard you, this applies to phase?
This is phase one.
It's just part of the agreement from phase
two. It's part of our agreement that we get to review on.
Right.
And we also put a maximum limit on what we were going to make available. So it,
for phase one over phase, correct?
Yeah.
Okay.
And so we're only at $1.1 million, so we're still a long ways from from that maximum. Okay.
Any questions? All right, seeing none, I would entertain a motion to approve.
I'll make a motion.
Second.
I have a motion from Alderman Stafford, a second from Alderman Stoll. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Council Bill 096 becomes Resolution R-049. Council Bill 097.
Council Bill 097 is a resolution authorizing the city administrator to enter an agreement with Bowers Engineering for engineering services, engineering design services in an amount not to exceed $40,000.
This is for the design of where we have conflicts with our water line on phase two, which is the from the South Walmart roadway up to Waters Road. We have a water line that crosses at Waters Road, then runs along the west side of the road. There are places along there that we do have conflicts with the new curb and gutter location. We also have five locations
where we have water lines across underneath 291. We have a new storm sewer that's going to be placed on the east side, so all those water lines will need to be lowered so they miss the new storm sewer. The way we worked with MoDOT is that we were only going to move those water lines that were in conflict with the new road design. So it didn't require us to just unilaterally move the water lines back away from the roadway. So this is was planned in the budget. We had $40,000 planned for engineering work this year. We have $360,000 for the construction work in the 2016 budget. We're looking at trying to include it as part of the MoDOT contract so that we minimize the potential impacts. If our contractor didn't lower sufficient, then they would have to come back in. That'd be extra cost. So we're trying to tie it into the MoDOT contract so we don't have any conflicts between our contractor and their contract.
And this cost is actually related to phase two.
This is a phase two cost.
This all the way up 291 to Waters Road?
Waters Road, that's the limit of the of phase two.
And that's the engineering.
We have about 1,000 feet of water line. Looks like it's going to have to be moved. That's underneath the curb. That's going to just have to get moved about 10 feet back. And then we have five crossings. And another advantage of doing it as part of the MoDOT contract is they will allow us not to put in casing, but actually open trench. We don't have to bore, I should say. So we have to put the casing in, but we don't have to bore it. We can actually open cut it, so that will reduce the cost significantly by installing the casing and then putting in the pipe.
Any other questions? Seeing none, I entertain a motion to approve.
Second.
I have a motion from Alderman Dahlman, and a second from Alderman Bowman. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? And Council Bill 097 becomes Resolution R050. Council Bill 098.
Council Bill 098 will actually be an ordinance, and it's an ordinance authorizing the city administrator to execute a settlement agreement with CenturyLink, first reading Council Bill 098. Can we take that one, Mr. Mayor?
Sure.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the ordinance necessary in order to approve the settlement with CenturyLink that I've told you about. It's within all the parameters that we've previously discussed. Eliminates the 10 tax protest lawsuits that CenturyLink has filed against us. It releases the $147,000, that money that we've been forced to hold in escrow. It also nets the city another $325,000 in settlement funds. So the net effect is you get all your legal fees back, you get the taxes released, and the city pockets about $250,000. And most importantly, all of the protests are done. And it's all agreed how they're going to pay taxes or fees in the future, and it's all consistent with the way we interpreted the agreement and the ordinance as compared to the way they have been doing it in the past. So I think that's all cleaned up, and I ask if you could do it as an ordinance tonight two times, because they really want to get it paid this year, and I'd really like you to get your money this year. So if we pass it, approve it, and sign it tonight, I can get it to them, and they have to pay us within 10 business days. So, and if there's any questions, I'd like to answer.
Any questions, Steve? I just want to say good job. We appreciate your efforts, and glad to get this settled.
Will we suspend the rule and vote on it twice?
Pass it to the second.
Motion from Alderman Coburn and a second from Alderman Dickerson to move to the second reading. Have a roll call, please.
Alderman Stahl?
Aye.
Alderman Coburn?
Aye.
Alderman Long?
Aye.
Alderman Dickerson?
Aye.
Alderman Dahlman?
Aye.
Alderman Bowman?
Aye.
Alderman Milner absent. Alderman Stafford?
Aye.
Council Bill 098 is an ordinance authorizing the city administrator to execute a settlement agreement with CenturyLink. Second reading, Council Bill 098.
Alderman Dahlman?
Aye.
Alderman Stahl?
Aye.
Alderman Bowman?
Aye.
Alderman Coburn?
Aye.
Alderman Milner? Absent. Alderman Dickerson?
Aye.
Alderman Long?
Aye.
Alderman Stafford?
Aye.
And Council Bill 098 becomes Ordinance 03342. Council Bill 099.
Council Bill 099 is an ordinance to amend Chapter 105 Elections of the City of Harrisonville Municipal Code of Ordinances. First reading, Council Bill 099.
We are bringing our ordinance to reflect the state statute. They have added this past year, no person shall qualify as a candidate for elected public office in the state of Missouri who has been found guilty or pled guilty to a felony or misdemeanor under the federal laws of the U.S., United States of America, or to a felony under the laws of the state or an offense committed in another state that would be considered a felony. And with opening, we open file next Tuesday. We need to make sure that we have this approved.
Are there any questions for Kim about this? Seeing none, I entertain a motion to suspend the ruling and move Council Bill 098 to the second reading. Or excuse me, 099 to second reading.
So moved.
Okay. A motion from Alderman Coburn, second from Alderman Dickerson. Roll call.
Alderman Stafford?
Aye.
Alderman Dahlman?
Aye.
Alderman Coburn?
Aye.
Alderman Long?
Aye.
Alderman Bowman?
Aye.
Alderman Dickerson?
Aye.
Alderman Milner, absent. Alderman Stahl.
Aye.
Council 099 is an ordinance to amend Chapter 105 Elections of the Harrisonville Municipal Code of Ordinances. Second reading, Council Bill 099.
Alderman Dickerson?
Aye.
Alderman Dahlman?
Aye.
Alderman Stahl?
Aye.
Alderman Long?
Aye.
Alderman Milner, absent. Alderman Stafford?
Aye.
Alderman Coburn?
Aye.
Alderman Bowman?
Aye.
And Council Bill 099 becomes Ordinance 03343. Council Bill 100.
Council Bill 100 is an ordinance to repeal Ordinance 3304 and to prohibit utility vehicles from being driven on streets within the city limits of Harrisonville. First reading, Council Bill 100.
Good evening, Chief.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor. Members of the Board of Aldermen, before you tonight is a ask to repeal the UTV Ordinance 2014. I was asked to look into this before the board was approved. In 2015, brought it back a little bit later with some safety measures that we added to the ordinance. To date, we've only had one license issued for this. It cost me about $350 to get the licenses because I need the numerical in order and then fluorescent center at the office for CNC and stuff like that. It needs to be changed annually. That's why I went to purchase them this year. I was going to get them back to the board since we charge a fee of $15 to ask you to repeal this ordinance. This was a big push by, if you remember, those of you that were on the board of Rochelle Wamas, for her father who wanted to use the UTV on the street. I did contact Rochelle last week and was going to tell her that, you know, this was on the agenda for tonight. She told me it's not a big deal to her. Her father has moved out of town. So. I'm just asking that...
push the easy button there, didn't you?
Just asking that you reconsider this and repeal. I do not feel that, and I didn't feel at the time that these were safe to operate on the street. So my request, my recommendation is that we repeal this ordinance. Happy to answer any questions.
Anybody have any questions? Seeing the lack of interest, I would agree that you see a need for it and for us to spend any more money to make these available at this time. So, you
know.
Chief, we need to. Yes, sir.
Will that affect us at all? If somebody's doing like a, we're trying to think of a festival or something where there's a closed street. And we've got them operating like Burn District for a festival, for example, and they've got them, and they're running trash or whatever.
Well, a city is allowed to use them, or a government agency is allowed to use them.
Long one, though. Thanks.
With this being an ordinance, I would entertain a motion to move this to the second reading. Suspend the ruling. All right. I have a motion from Alderman Dickerson.
Second.
Second from Alderman Coburn.
Alderman Milner, absent. Alderman Coburn?
Aye.
Alderman Dahlman?
Aye.
Alderman Stafford?
Aye.
Alderman Long?
Aye.
Alderman Bowman?
Aye.
Alderman Stahl?
Aye.
Alderman Dickerson?
Aye.
Council Bill 100 is an ordinance to repeal Ordinance 3304, prohibit utility vehicles from being driven on streets within the city limits of Harrisonville. Second reading, Council Bill 100.
Alderman Dickerson?
Aye.
Alderman Dahlman?
Aye.
Alderman Stahl?
Aye.
Alderman Coburn?
Aye.
Alderman Milner? Absent. Alderman Stafford?
Aye.
Alderman Bowman?
Aye.
Alderman Long?
Aye.
And Council Bill 100 becomes ordinance 03344. And we will now move back to agenda item B, Council Bill 091.
Council Bill 091 is an ordinance vacating a portion of Burkhart Drive adjacent to house development in Harrisonville, Cass County, Missouri. First reading, Council Bill 091.
Good evening.
If you don't mind, I may talk about all three of these issues on the agenda tonight altogether. Basically, there's three things. The vacation of the right-of-way that will not be used, the final plat, which dedicates easements and right-of-ways with it, and also the development agreement that allows site construction, building construction, and infrastructure going concurrently. Basically, it's a 24-acre site, and the site itself for the Love's development is about half that. During this development, there was infrastructure, or is infrastructure being constructed, roadway, electric, water, sewer, stormwater, sort of the whole gamut of things going on here, and it's currently being constructed. What we're doing is we're doing the vacation and the final plat concurrently, as well as the development agreement, to where we can wrap it all up so there's no overlap, so we know there's always going to be a right-of-way connecting the two into the roadway along with commercial up to the intersection. And that way, it would also help expedite it, because if we did it once the road was completed, then we'd have to go ahead and do right-of-ways and hold meetings and everything like that. So, are there any questions?
Any questions for anybody else? Any on one of these three items? Entertain a motion to suspend the ruling on Council Bill 091 in the second reading. Motion from Alderman Dolman. And a second from Alderman Bowman.
Alderman Dickerson?
Aye.
Alderman Dolman?
Aye.
Alderman Stahl?
Aye.
Alderman Stafford?
Aye.
Alderman Bowman?
Aye.
Alderman Long?
Aye.
Alderman Milner, absent. Alderman Coburn?
Aye.
Council Bill 091 is an ordinance vacating a portion of Burkhart Drive adjacent to the Love's development in Harrisonville, Cass County, Missouri. Second reading, Council Bill 091.
Alderman Stafford?
Aye.
Alderman Long?
Aye.
Alderman Stahl?
Aye.
Alderman Bowman?
Aye.
Alderman Milner, absent. Alderman Dickerson?
Aye.
Alderman Coburn?
Aye.
Alderman Dolman?
Aye.
And Council Bill 091 becomes ordinance 03345. Council Bill 092.
Council Bill 092 is an ordinance to accept final plat of Love's addition, a subdivision of land in sections 4 and 5 of Township 44 North, Range 31 West, in the city of Harrisonville, Cass County, Missouri. First reading, Council Bill 092.
Again, I'd entertain a motion to suspend the ruling and move Council Bill 092 to the second reading.
So moved.
Motion from Alderman Stahl.
Second.
Second from Alderman Stafford.
Alderman Stahl?
Aye.
Alderman Coburn?
Aye.
Alderman Long?
Aye.
Alderman Dickerson?
Aye.
Alderman Dolman?
Aye.
Alderman Bowman?
Aye.
Alderman Milner, absent. Alderman Stafford?
Aye.
Council Bill 092 is an ordinance to accept final plat of Love's addition, a subdivision of land in sections 3 and 4 and 5 in Township 44 North, Range 31 West, in the city of Harrisonville, Cass County, Missouri. Second reading, Council Bill 092.
Alderman Dolman?
Aye.
Alderman Stahl?
Aye.
Alderman Bowman?
Aye.
Alderman Coburn?
Aye.
Alderman Milner, absent. Alderman Dickerson?
Aye.
Alderman Long?
Aye.
Alderman Stafford?
Aye.
And Council Bill 092 becomes ordinance 03346. Council Bill 093.
Council Bill 093 is an ordinance authorizing city administrative action development agreement in connection with the Love's addition generally located at Burkhart Drive Road and South Commercial Street. First reading, Council Bill 093.
I'd entertain a motion to suspend the ruling for Council Bill 093 to the second reading.
So moved.
Motion from Alderman Dolman.
Second.
Second from Alderman Stafford.
Alderman Long?
Aye.
Alderman Dolman?
Aye.
Alderman Coburn?
Aye.
Alderman Stafford?
Aye.
Alderman Bowman?
Aye.
Alderman Dickerson?
Aye.
Alderman Milner, absent. Alderman Stahl?
Aye.
Council Bill 093
is an ordinance authorizing the city administrator to execute a development agreement in connection with the Love's Edition, generally located at Burkhart Road and South Commercial Street. Second Council Bill 093.
Alderman Stafford?
Aye.
Alderman Long?
Aye.
Alderman Stoll?
Aye.
Alderman Bowman?
Aye.
Alderman Milner, absent. Alderman Dickerson?
Aye.
Alderman Cooper?
Aye.
Alderman Dahlman?
Aye.
And Council Bill 093 becomes Ordinance 03347. Alderman and Committee Reports. Alderman Stafford, you are first tonight, sir.
Nothing really to report. Happy holidays, Merry Christmas, everybody. Hope we're having a good Thanksgiving.
Alderman Stoll.
I'd just like to report on the buildings on the old way off Broadway Players building. It's now owned by the Heart of Life Church in Bourbon City. And there, we had a need for youth. And this is going to answer, you know, one of these problems, because that building's going to be turned into a youth center. We have one in Peculiar, the old, it's just on J there. That's our campus. We have outgrown that. So we're attracting people from all around. But this is going to be, it's going to be the church offices, and it's going to be the youth center. Individual bought that land and donated it to the church.
Somebody had mentioned the other day they thought that that might have sold, and I had not heard that, so that building is of particular interest to me. That was my grandparents' furniture store at one time, and so it's
going to be used again.
Yeah, there is actually a wall in between two of the rooms where there's measurements from the kids all through the years. You'll have to look for that, but that's exciting that building, so that's a best building in the world to play hide and go seek in. It was a lot easier when there was a lot of furniture in there, though. You had lots of places to hide. So that's great. I'm glad to hear that. Alderman Long.
I don't have much to add other than if everyone has happy holidays, if you don't have anything, other meetings tomorrow or whatever. Wish the staff and everyone a good Christmas.
Good. Alderman Dixon. Alderman Cooper.
I'd like to wish everyone a happy Hanukkah and to remind everyone today's Pearl Harbor Day.
Important day.
That's because you're not old enough.
Alderman Dahl.
I guess I address my concern, I guess, to Brian and Mike. My question here that I have, with the veto of that of the increase, what repercussions are we going to have from? Are we going to revert back to without the increase? How is that going to affect?
With the ordinance failing on the water and sewer and utility rate increase, that means that our current rates stay in effect. So there just wouldn't be any change in that. We were going to submit our new rates to DNR as part of our application for funding through the SRF program, and so we'll be submitting our current rates through them. Not necessarily very optimistic that would have any that work, because the formula that they give us says that, you know, that's probably not going to generate enough money. We have a rate schedule in place now that funds our current operations, but to try to accommodate an additional debt load, it makes sense that we have to have additional revenues as well. DNR generally does not tell you what your rates should be. They'll tell you whether they are sufficient or not. So we'll send in our current rates and see what that does, but we're anticipating that that won't be sufficient and that we'll have to come back to the drawing board. But I don't believe they're gonna say your rate should be this much per gallon or this much, whatever. That's gonna be our job to do that and to submit something to that. The real question is where that puts us on the timetable for being included in their funding, because this is part of an application process that we are going through to try to qualify for that funding. That They can't tell us what our rate should be, but they can tell us whether or not we can make it into their funding program. You recall the SRF program is a, it's a way to subsidize, you know, to lower the borrowing or the interest rate that we would be paying. So instead of paying a market rate, if we were to issue revenue bonds straight to the public, we would probably be looking at 4-4.5%, maybe something like that, on an issue like this. And the SRF program is anticipated at a cost of about 1.5%. So there's a significant savings and good reason to try to participate with SRF if we can. It doesn't impact the city's ability to borrow the money legally, because the voters last year were asked that question and they did approve the city issuing bonds. And part of that educational process of doing that included, you know, the prospect of raising the rates to pay for that, because that's, you know, otherwise everybody would want improvements if you didn't have to pay for them. So that was part of the process. We still have the legal authority to issue those bonds, but it becomes a process of how do you do it, what program do you use to go through to do that. If you do it through the SRF, or if you try to do a private placement of that, whoever is going to buy the bonds, whether it's the SRF program or individual bond purchasers, they're going to want to see rates sufficient to pay that back. Anybody, any lender would want to see that. So that's still going to be in front of us. The practical effect is, right now we don't know what's going to happen. We're going to send our current rates in to the SRF, and they'll let us know what becomes of that. If they say, no, this isn't going to be eligible, then we'll probably have to back our engineers off of doing further design work, because it would make sense that we wouldn't be trying to design something if we're not going to build it. We wouldn't want to be spending that kind of money. So to my way of thinking, this puts our schedule of water or improvements to our wastewater treatment plant kind of on hold or in limbo. And I'm accepting, of course, the work that we're already doing on the filter, because that's not part of the proposed SRF borrowing. That's accomplished with monies that we have in hand from the sale of the asset that we had when we purchased the rights to Kansas City Water. And then when we sold that, we had that money back in the bank, and we're using that for certain improvements outside of the SRF project. So the $7 million on the SRF project is we'll have to get back to you and let you know what happens to that, if that's going to be possible or not. Well, we'll be sending in the information to SRF, and they will let us know. I don't know what their timetable is to do that, but I would imagine it won't take long.
We've already run the current rates through their model. Based on what our 20-year capital improvement plans are, this shows that it's not adequate. And so we have to come up with rates that would be adequate. SRF has already stated that they prefer rate structures where your fixed costs are loaded into your base rate, and that variable costs are in your volume charges. Right now, we have a rate structure that actually benefits the lower income seniors, because we have a small base rate, but we have a high volume rate. And my hope was to be able to show that benefit exists with the new rate structure that is adequate to meet their requirements. This has brought our rates under a little more scrutiny, because I had to tell them that there may be an issue with our proposed rates, and we'll have to use our current rates. And so my question to SRF: would you accept our rate structure in its present form, as opposed to going to what they've talked about, putting all your fixed cost into your base rate? And they said, we would consider it, but not likely accept it. And so I think we're going to have a tough road moving forward if we try to keep the same type of rate structure that we currently have. And even if we increase rates now, I think if we just increase the per $1,000 cost, I think they're going to request that we put more money into the fixed rate. And I think Marcella had some experience with SRF in a previous job where they had to do the same thing, that they had to move more of their fixed cost into base rate and reduce the volume cost. So I just don't, they certainly won't accept our current rates. It already shows a negative value. So it won't take them long to review and say, you need to come back with a different proposal.
When was our last rate increase on the water?
Last year.
Huh?
Last year.
What happened to that? I don't recall off the top of my head.
It was a good chunk of that.
It's in that information that you were provided, hopefully looked at. We had that work session when we went over rates and proposed that, and there's a spreadsheet in there, and it has the rate increase by year on that. So it's in that, but I don't have that in front of me. I'm sorry, Dave.
Okay, so when we got the bond voting before the voters, at that time, I understood that the rate structure that we had in existence to file for SRS had already been approved. That is what I was led to believe in. That our rate structure that was set before us to do the bonding, they had already preliminary approved our
rate structure. No, they never.
Because that funding, the paperwork or whatever it was delayed for whatever the reason was. I don't know what it was. It was supposed to have been turned in sooner than we have done it now, from my understanding. From two of the meetings that I had, was that your understanding? So I don't know where that was at, but I know we should have. I know that was never discussed, that SRS was going to not okay our funding because of our rate structure. That I knew of back then when we were going for the bonds.
They never made any comments about a rate structure. I've submitted the rate structure that we had been using, and they said, well, here. And they sent me their rate structure and said, this is what we like to use.
Because at the time, I was leery if it was going to increase our rates. And if you remember, I tried to get Burns and McDonald to go on a piecemeal section so we wouldn't have to raise our rates in the, a big chunk. And then that was my concern all along, is going to raise water rates. And then somewhere along the line, the information said, well, that wasn't going to, they would be all at once and our rate structure was in place for it.
As part of the educational campaign that the city had, I think we talked about in that material, there was disclosed a rate increase of about $3.25 a thousand gallons.
Something. I don't know what it was. So, I know that never was an issue.
So the voters took all that information to heart and said, yes, proceed with this.
Yeah. At that time, there was no concern about SRS funding at our current rate structure. That was never in any of the discussions that I went to. Or there would have been some changes, or we didn't know what was headed down the line in front of us. So I don't know how that's become an issue now, that we're hanging on what they say, because they never had a question before about a rate structure.
I would think there's some common sense. We think if you have a $13 million project, that you would have to raise, go with the project, the rate structure would have to go up with.
Well,
I'm
not saying that. I'm just saying there was no talk about SRS examining our rate structure. I was led to believe that they were on board for it at the time.
Because if we can't go through with the water project, now we're not doing what the voters asked us to do.
We still have the bond. We have the bond, regardless of what happens. We still have the bonds that can be issued. There's no guarantee they were going to approve the rate structure we submitted either.
But we can't issue the bonds without the ability to pay for them, because no one would sell us an think the bond amount is in the $7 million range.
That's what was approved, plus the
bond that was approved was $7 million, and we had using $2 million, $2.5 million. At that time, we were looking at a $9.5 million project, and $2.5 million from a previous bond issue.
But people who are going to loan you that kind of money are going to expect that you're going to have a revenue stream sufficient to pay that.
Right.
And that's similar to the same type of, we had to go through and get approval when we went through the funding on the sewer plant in 2010, as well as the ones that predated you.
Yeah.
You know, and SRF does have to approve, you have to jump, if you're going to utilize their program, you have to meet their standards to qualify for that program.
And we went for $8 million on that sewer project and only and kept four. We only needed $4 million instead of the $8 to sponsor. Well, that's where he got the $2 million. That could be,
yeah, we just won 4.3 of
the, we had saved money.
We got that project. We got a big ERA grant.
Mike?
Yes.
May I?
Sure.
Please, Mayor?
You, absolutely.
The way I understand it, the SRF money that was issued in 2010 was all processed, and we went through the whole piece, you know, as far as the rate structures. In the last 5 years, DNR has changed their requirements. They are scrutinizing rates across the state to use that. And so that's the reason why now, you know, they may have looked at our rate model or our rate structure, but they didn't require us to plug those formulas in to their rate model. And so that changed 12, 13, somewhere in there, because when I worked for the city of Odessa, we had to do the same thing. And we hadn't anticipated that before, nor had we had to do that back in 2006 when we had utilized that program. So that's part of the challenge, is you may not have, because that bond issue was done, what, 2 years ago? Is that right? You know, so maybe those conversations didn't take place, but because DNR has now changed those qualifications and the requirements of the documents from the city, that's the reason why we're having to do that, and they are looking at those rate structures. So it's not that we missed something or that we didn't communicate it completely. I think they've changed the rules on us. So that's just an FYI.
That's all I have.
Alderman Bowen?
Well, you all have heard me say from this dais before that I think that every member of this board ought to be able to support and stand behind every vote that they cast, whether it's an aye vote or a nay vote. And I voted in favor of the utility rate increases because the people of Harrisonville voted for that. And I represent the people who live and vote in Harrisonville. I am disturbed and distressed that we would pass up a project like this. I am distressed that we would pass up the opportunity for low interest rate money coming out of SRF. I am distressed that we are doing something counter to what our voters have asked. Voters have been asking for years for better tasting water, water with no odor, and we had a way to do that. We had a way to be able to provide that for them by rehabbing our plant and by utilizing low interest rate money to do so. And now our mayor has put a lump of coal in the stocking of every resident of Harrisonville this Christmas. Because our mayor is not fulfilling the desire of the voters of the city. And so, because you have done that, Mr. Mayor, I think the citizens of Harrisonville deserve to hear from you. What is your plan? How are you going to provide them the quality of drinking water that they've said they wanted and that they deserve to have? I feel like you're negating the voice of everybody in Harrisonville by taking this stand. And I would respectfully request that you consider rescinding your veto.
for starters, the ordinance includes more than just the water rate. There are other two, there are two other increases. I can't line item anything and say, I want this removed, that removed. Number two, I did talk with Mr. Tholen about this before I submitted this, and we discussed submitting the rates at the current rate to see what comes back. The voters asked me, when I ran for office, to make decisions to, I said I would not support rate increases unless there was a dire need or there was a absolute. If DNR comes back, there's no guarantee they were going to accept the rates that we put in place. What if they came back and said that's insufficient? You then are turning around and raising rates twice in a year's period. And if you think this room was full before with other items that were highly contested, this room will be packed out the hall because we have increased water rates twice. I have had numerous people, I would say in the two dozen range, stop me complaining about rate increases. Yes, they voted for the water bonds. Now, what a lot of them don't realize is, yes, that there can be increases associated with bonds. They did not realize that piece. I'm not saying that the information was not made available. You know, we all know everybody doesn't always read what's in front of them. I mean, the information was out there to read, but what they saw on the ballot is, shall the city of Harrisonville be allowed to issue water bonds in the amount of $7 million? It doesn't say in the fine print below it, by the way, this will include increases of X, Y, and Z. They didn't see that portion. So, my number one, I wasn't in favor of either one after thinking through this and just talking. I was out eating at the barbecue restaurant and hearing the businesses out in that corridor that are down in sales. I mean, the construction project out there is behind schedule. I mean, it's I don't know how far behind it is, but I know that bridge was supposed to be open in July. It didn't open until months later. They are hurting out there. And so that right there was enough for me to say I don't support the two increases to sewer and trash. They're not a make or break deal. But again, the water, if they come back and say your rate's not sufficient, well, we have to then decide what's going to be a sufficient rate. Then we have valid reason to say we need to raise the rates. And if somebody wants to ask me, I say, well, we did this project, we have to have these rates. And at this time, we will see what they come back with.
So may I respond?
You may respond.
So do I understand you to say then that when DNR comes back and says this will need to be your rate in order to qualify for the SRF, then you're going to approve a rate?
Well, they're not going to come back and tell us what. I mean, that's what Mike right. is saying. They I don't mean, tell you. It would be great if they would tell you that, so right. you knew in black and white. Yeah, if they come back and say this is not sufficient, then we will have to say, okay, now we have to look at rates.
And so then are you going to approve a rate increase then when they come back and say this rate is not sufficient?
We will see what they come back with, and then at that time we will sit down and discuss what we think we're going to need to do.
We will discuss it.
Yes, absolutely.
All of us
will absolutely. We will all discuss it. Mm-hmm. It'll have to come back at this point, because to remove those two items, I would have to veto the whole ordinance anyway. So at this point, we need to submit our rates. If they come back that they are not sufficient, we will readdress the water rate at that time.
And then how does that affect the project, Mike? How does that kind of a delay affect the overall project?
We had we have been on the preliminary list. It's not the funded list, but it's the
fundable
list.
Yeah.
And so now we're going through the process of doing all the application stuff to move from being fundable, meaning the project makes sense, to being funded, meaning we have met all the requirements to participate in the program. And the time frame on that, I'm trying to think of when they...
We were trying to look at taking bonds in late April, May is when we were, and it takes them 60 to 90 days to issue the bonds. So we were hoping we could be under construction by July, August at the latest. And it's a year to 15-month project once we get it under construction.
When are they going to have the filters finally put in?
Filters are due to be completed in April.
So you couldn't start anything before that?
Yeah, I mean, it's not planned to start.
But they were working, they can go parallel to them, or they don't have to be done one before the other.
Well, once the project is actually funded and we're approved on that, then we would have to go out for bids and do all that. So we wouldn't be having a construction overlap with the filters, but it's trying to get these things lined up and continuing in the process. And I think Alderman Goldman's question was, what does this do to that timeframe if we don't make an April funding? When would their next funding be?
Well, your applications are due in February to get on the next year's funding list. If we aren't able to make this one go, then we have to have an application in by February. And it will take a year, and it will be another 12 months.
So if I understand that, then our next application would be February of 2017.
Right.
And we're looking at at least another year's delay.
It would not get approved
after
until
that.
Fall. It just got approved in October, so
fall
you get approved
of 2017.
In October, and then you have to go through the same analysis that we're going through right now, and it'll take 6-7 months to go through that process to get approved.
So this veto is costing us somewhere between 2.5 and 3 years delay on our project.
That's assuming we would get SRF. We're probably talking about another year, at least another year. You can always go out and get private financing,
right,
and pay a higher interest rate, spread it out instead of 20 years, make it a 25 year, so you can keep your payments at least the same, but you end up paying considerably more long term.
Right.
And that was the reason we didn't go with private financing, is it was going to cost us about $1 million more, because we had to extend the project from 20 years to 22 years at the same rate.
Is that all this evening?
That's all for me.
All right. Mr. Coleman.
Right now, we do not have anything scheduled for our second meeting in December, which would be December the 21st. You recall that we previously had a discussion about some potential development projects that may require a special meeting that the board had indicated they would be supportive of that if that came up. It would be a single purpose type of meeting. And we don't have that right now, but if that does come up, we'll of course try to get everybody rounded up and notice up the meeting for that. But right now we do not have anything scheduled for the meeting of December 21st. And so unless that changes pretty quickly, we'll probably recommend canceling that meeting. That's the beginning of Christmas week. And I think probably most people will find something else that they might do with their time. Also as a reminder, city offices will be closed on December 24th and 25th, Thursday and Friday, for that observance, as well as the next week, January 1st, Friday, New Year's Day. And that leads us into our next regular scheduled meeting, so about January 2016.
Very good. What was the date? January what?
January 4th. It would be our first meeting of 2016. A reminder that Kim already mentioned, filing for municipal offices, and we'll have one alderman position open in each of the four wards. Starts next Tuesday, a week from tomorrow, and is open for a month until sometime in January. But filing begins at 8 a.m.
Next Tuesday,
which would be the 15th of December. So, if you want an opportunity to serve, highly recommend it. And I would echo all the aldermen's comments about wishing everyone a happy holiday, Merry Christmas, Happy New Year, whatever works for you.
Very good.
Very good. Well, this weekend, this last weekend, of course, was the lighting of the Christmas tree on the square. Pretty sure we had a record turnout, Opie, is that correct for the...
We estimate the crowd at 300.
There was a very sizable crowd, and everything seemed to go well. All the events on the square, the Bright Future Shopping event, had a line out the door when I saw it. The kids seemed to enjoy sitting on Santa's lap. The carriage rides were a big hit. I think the weather was definitely in our favor. I wanted to thank Alderman Long and Alderman Dickerson for stopping by the mayor's Christmas party down at the youth building. We had a decent turnout for a first-time event. We raised a little over $200 that we're donating to Bright Futures. We're going to look to continue that event in the future and try to expand on it. But anyway, it was the whole evening was good. The weather was good, and everybody seemed to have a good time. So I know I'm looking forward to the holidays, and hope everybody else has a happy holiday, and we look forward to the new year. So, any questions from you tonight, Max?
If I could just catch you after the meeting.
Absolutely. We do have a closed meeting tonight, so if it's
it'd
be easier to call, I can always call you, or if it's quick, we can do it tonight.
I'll catch you.
All right.
Yeah.
Ivan?
I move that the board of aldermen go into closed session pursuant to the following sections of the revised statutes of Missouri, section 610.0213, to discuss personnel matters.
Second.
I need a second.
Yeah, second, please.
Alderman Bowman?